Archaeology, a branch of science that sheds light on the history of life and mankind. Archaeologists carry out long and difficult excavations looking for clues, such as tools, works of art, household items, and the like, that can provide clues about the history of life and living things. Every remain they find is a discovery in the name of history and an important resource that can illuminate the history of life and of mankind. Coins. Hand tools. Kitchen equipment and decorative goods all provide important clues about the lives of people in the past. Archaeologists know that the items they find do not appear under the ground by chance. Nobody has ever claimed that they do. Even if we do not actually witness these items being made, we can still be certain of the existence of people who designed and made them. Together with the information they contain, all these objects and artifacts are intelligent designs. They were designed and produced for a specific purpose. They reflect the labor, expertise, taste, and intelligence of the artists who made them. It would be quite irrational to suggest that any intelligent design came into being by chance, under the effects of natural conditions. So, what about life? How should people who realize that even a simple artifact from under the ground is the product of design account for the origin of living things? Each one of which has its own complexity. Mankind has made enormous advances in science and technology since the second half of the 20th century. Discoveries in the field of biophysics, biochemistry, and genetics in particular have shown scientists that the details that go to make up life are of a far greater complexity than they had ever imagined. However, scientists who became greatly excited at the discovery of a simple remain were much less excited when they discovered the complex structure of life. This dilemma was expressed by the American biochemist Michael Behe, one of today's best-known scientists. Over the past four decades, modern biochemistry has uncovered the secrets of the cell. The progress has been hard-won. It has required tens of thousands of people to dedicate the better parts of their lives to the tedious work of the laboratory. The result of these cumulative efforts to investigate the cell, to investigate life at the molecular level, is a loud, clear, piercing cry of design. The result is so unambiguous and so significant that it must be ranked as one of the greatest achievements in the history of science. But no hands clapped. Why does the scientific community not greedily embrace its startling discovery? The dilemma is that while one side of the issue is labeled intelligent design, the other side must be labeled God. The cell and a great many living things in nature show us the superior knowledge, intelligence, and artistry of the Creator who brought them into being. That superior Creator is God, the Lord of all the worlds. He is God, the Creator, the Maker, the Giver of form. To Him belong the most beautiful names. Everything in the heavens and earth glorifies Him. He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. The The allegedly scientific theory, which rejects the creation of living things and seeks to account for the origin of life in terms of blind chance, is Charles Darwin's theory of evolution. Darwin set out his theory in the book The Origin of Species, published in 1859. According to Darwin, all life comes from a common ancestor, and life forms evolved from one another by small, gradual changes. For instance, dinosaurs, which used their forearms to feed, gradually grew wings and took flight. Or bears, which hunted fish in the water, turned into whales over the course of time. Yet this claim was a violation of both reason and intellect, as well as science, and the theory, devoid as it was of any scientific evidence, clearly revealed the perversion of denying the existence of a creator. Darwin maintained that there was a constant struggle to the death in nature. According to his unscientific claims, food resources were insufficient, and there was a ruthless war going on in the arena known as Earth, one in which the strong and those able to adapt to natural conditions survived, and in which the weak and sickly species were eliminated. The concept of conflict, which can be seen in the subtitle to The Origin of Species, the preservation of the favored races in the struggle for life, was one of the foundation stones of the theory of evolution. According to Darwin, individuals which possessed advantages in this struggle for life would survive and multiply. These advantageous differences would thus combine and give rise to new features, new organs, and new species. The fact that this claim of Darwin's is a totally imaginary one would only later be revealed by means of advances in the field of science. On close inspection, this claim of Darwin's, in an evolutionary process that progressed from 1 to 5 stages, required that for a living species to survive, each individual stage had to give rise to a more advantageous physiological structure than the one preceding it. That meant that the theory of evolution rested entirely upon the assumption that living systems could be reduced to minute but advantageous steps. Useful features would be chosen by the mechanism Darwin referred to as natural selection, and non-useful ones would be eliminated and disappear. In this way, beneficial small changes accumulating over the course of time would in the long term lead to one species turning into another.
For Charles Darwin, natural selection explained the appearance of design without a designer. There was no longer any need to invoke an intelligent cause for the complexity of life. In effect, natural selection became a kind of designer substitute.
This claim, however, could never account for exceedingly complex organs and systems, which are incapable of developing by degrees and which cannot be reduced to a simpler form. Irreducibly complex organs and systems that will cease to have any function in the absence of any one of their components deal a serious blow to the theory of evolution. That is because it is impossible to propose that an organ that will not function in the absence of even the smallest of its components evolved gradually through a series of minute changes. Charles Darwin was aware of this and wrote in his book The Origin of Species, "If it could be demonstrated that any complex organ existed, which could not possibly have been formed by numerous successive slight modifications, my theory would absolutely break down. But I can find out no such case." It might have been regarded as normal in Darwin's own time for him to say he can find no such case, because in the second half of the 19th century, the world of science was at a rather primitive technological level compared to that of today. Under their primitive microscopes, life did indeed appear to have only a simple structure. At that time, when the cell was described as a simple little lump of carbon, Darwin was unaware of the meaning of the words genetics, electron microscope, or biochemistry. Yet scientific discoveries in the 20th century would lead the idea that life was simple being consigned to the waste bin of history. In 1931, the German scientist Ernst Ruska invented the electron microscope. It was seen that cells, hitherto considered to be little lumps of carbon, were actually extraordinarily complex life forms, capable of multiplying on their own and producing energy, and with special defensive systems to protect them from enemies. Darwin's unrealistic idea that the first cell came into existence by chance was thus totally invalidated. In 1955, James Watson and Francis Crick revealed, with the discovery of the structure of the DNA, that living things contained very special genetic information encoded in the nuclei of their cells, and that this data could not be changed by acquired characteristics. Advances in the field of fossil science also placed the theory of evolution in a worsening quandary with every passing day. There was not a trace of the intermediate forms alleged to link species to one another. According to the theory, it took millions of years for one species to evolve into another. That meant that from the physiological point of view, there should be thousands, even millions of intermediate forms between them. The number of fossils belonging to these should be numbered in the trillions, and the strata of the Earth should be full of such forms. However, despite decades of excavations, not a single intermediate form, of all the millions and even billions there should in theory be, has ever been encountered. Today, speculation continues with regard to just a few dozen fossils, and all of these have in any case been proven not to be intermediate forms, but rather particular and extinct specimens. Today, even the best-known evolutionist paleontologists honestly admit that they have no longer any hope that intermediate forms will ever be found. One of these, Stephen Jay Gould, says in one of his books, "As we survey the history of life, one feature stands out as most puzzling, the lack of clear order and progress through time among marine invertebrate faunas. We can tell tales of improvement for some groups, but in honest moments we must admit that the history of complex life is more a story of multifarious variation about a set of basic designs than a saga of accumulating excellence. The eyes of early trilobites, for example, have never been exceeded for complexity or acuity by later arthropods. Why do we fail to find this expected order?" The electron microscope and the discovery of the structure of the DNA, the conclusion reached by modern-day paleontology, these alone were sufficient to tear down the already unsteady foundations of the theory of evolution proposed by Darwin. However, one of the most serious blows to the theory of evolution came only recently from the field of biochemistry. According to Michael Behe, a professor of biochemistry at Lehigh University in Pennsylvania, it is impossible for the complex organs in living things to have come about by means of natural selection and mutations, which shows that the cell was created.
It's really interesting to notice that the more we know about life and the more we know about biology, the more problems Darwinism has and the more design becomes apparent. For the longest time, I believed that Darwinian evolution explained what we saw in biology, not because I saw how it could actually explain it, but because I was told that it did explain it. In schools, I was taught Darwinian biology. And through college and graduate school, I was in an atmosphere which just assumed that Darwinian evolution explained biology. And again, I didn't have any reason to doubt it. It wasn't until about 10 years or more ago that I read a book called Evolution, a Theory in Crisis by a geneticist by the name of Michael Denton, an Australian. And he put forward a lot of scientific arguments against Darwinian theory that I had never heard before. And the arguments seemed pretty convincing. And at that point, I started to get a bit angry because I thought I was being led down the primrose path. Here were a number of very good arguments, and I had gone through a doctoral program in biochemistry, became a faculty member, and I had never even heard of these things. And so from that point on, I became very interested in the question of evolution, and since have decided the Darwinian processes are not the whole explanation for life.
In his book, Darwin's Black Box, The Biochemical Challenge to Evolution, Behe describes how in Darwin's time, the living cell was a black box whose contents were unknown, and how with the unraveling of the details within the cell, it emerged that it was actually a very complex structure. The powerful evidence in Behe's book was greeted with despair among evolutionist circles, and the work itself was soon being discussed by well-known media organizations. One of the points most concentrated on by Behe is that of irreducible complexity. According to Darwin's assumptions, complex organs in living things, such as the eye, ear, and heart, assumed their present forms by means of minute and gradual changes over billions of years. Scientific research reveals, however, that it is impossible for these organs, and in particular for the molecular machinery inside the cell, to have developed in stages. These are very complex structures consisting of a combination of small components. The system will serve no purpose at all if any of those components fails to fulfill its function. With these compound structures, these organs and systems possess a complexity that cannot be reduced to a simpler form. The best known example of irreducible complexity is the whip mechanism found in certain bacteria. The bacterial flagellum, a whip-like extension, has been known for a long time. Observations in the last decade, however, astonished the scientific world when they revealed its detailed structure. That is because the whip was shown to function not with a simple vibratory mechanism, as had been thought earlier, but with a very complex organic motor. Bacteria use the flagellum to move. This whip is the only organ in the world of living things capable of a genuine rotating movement. Thanks to this, the bacterium moves in whichever direction it wishes, and can also make sudden stops and maneuvers. Thanks to the flagellum's spiral fibers and the engine in the root, the bacterium can spin like a propeller. The engine that permits the bacteria to move consists of two separate sections, the rotor and the stator, that provide a spinning movement within one another. Moreover, instead of ready stored energy, a flow of acid in the bacteria membranes is used as a source of energy. The engine mechanism consists of 40 different components, a structure with a complexity that cannot be reduced to a simple form.
If even one of these pieces is missing or put in the wrong place, your motor isn't going to work. So this apparatus to assemble the flagellar motor is itself irreducibly complex.
The flagellum also possesses an internally complex structure. Its organic structure consists of 240 separate kinds of protein. These components cannot have come together in small changes over the course of time to produce the bacterial flagellum. Since every tiny component is an organ that serves no purpose on its own. In the absence of the engine system that provides the rotating movement, for example, the bacterium would still be incapable of movement, even if it somehow came into existence by chance. According to the theory of evolution, organs that are not in use gradually become vestigial and disappear. From that point of view, in an evolutionary process consisting of 40 separate changes, any organ forming in the first stage will be weeded out by natural selection, since it fails to fulfill any function, and the evolutionary process will come to a halt right at the outset. This scientific fact is outlined by Dr. Jonathan Wells.
The important thing to realize about natural selection is it selects only for a functional advantage. In most cases, natural selection actually eliminates things that have no function or that have a function that harms the organism. So if you had a bacterium with a tail that didn't function as a flagellum, chances are natural selection would eliminate it. The only way you can select for a flagellum is if you have a flagellum that works, and that means you have to have all the pieces of the motor in place to begin with. So natural selection can't get you the bacterial flagellum. It can only work after the flagellum is there and operating.
This situation, which is true for the bacterial flagellum, also applies to its other components and organs. Modern-day science reveals the meaninglessness of the theory of evolution's claim of gradual development in the face of the complexity of the bacterial flagellum. Indeed, no evolutionist biologist has been able to account for the flagellum's origins. The bacterial flagellum can only exist if all its components work flawlessly and at the same time. This in turn means only one thing, creation. In the same way that the engines that allow cars to move are the products of superior engineering, so this mechanism that allows bacteria to move is the product of a superior knowledge. That knowledge belongs to God, the Lord of all the worlds. Living things came into being not through a random stage-by-stage process, but were created from nothing in a single moment. Almighty God reveals this in these verses from the Quran. God created every animal from water. Some of them go on their bellies, some of them on two legs, and some on four. God creates whatever He wills. God has power over all things. He is the originator of the heavens and earth. When He decides on something, He just says to it, "Be," and it is. In the same way that structures that cannot be reduced to a simpler form demolish the claims of the myth of evolution, The fine detail they possess reveals to us, with the most striking examples, God's artistry and matchless intellect. The signs of creation in living things have now become a scientific concept and are supported against Darwinism by the world's best known scientists. Among the most prominent names in this movement are those of Philip Johnson from the University of California at Berkeley, William Dembski from MIT, Chicago, and Princeton universities, Stephen C. Meyer, who earned his PhD from Cambridge University, and Paul Nelson from Chicago University. As well as maintaining that life did not come into existence by chance, and that God created all living things, these scientists hold seminars and conferences all over the world. Another organ that cannot be reduced to a simpler form is the ear. The human ear consists of several components, and hearing is the result of all these working in harmony together. A deficiency in any one of these components means that a person either becomes deaf or else suffers severe hearing difficulties. Brief details of how hearing actually takes place will enable us to understand how complex the process is, as well as the sensitive balances on which it is constructed. As we know, hearing begins with vibrations moving through the air. These vibrations are reinforced in the auricle. In this way, the intensity of the sound waves is amplified by approximately 17 decibels on entering the outer ear, from where the sound vibrations reach the ear membrane. The ear membrane is so sensitive that it can perceive vibrations of the dimensions of a single molecule. It is thanks to this sensitivity that in a silent environment we can hear someone whispering from many meters away. The ear membrane enhances the vibrations reaching it and transmits them to the middle ear. Here, there are three small bones in contact with one another in a very sensitive balance. These three bones, known as the anvil, hammer, and stirrup, enhance the vibrations reaching them from the membrane. The mechanical movements we have described so far begin turning into sound in the region known as the inner ear. The inner ear contains a liquid-covered organ known as the cochlea. The final component of the middle ear, the stirrup, is connected to a membrane on the entrance to the cochlea. Mechanical vibrations in the middle ear are transmitted to the cochlear fluid by means of this membrane. The vibrations reaching the inner ear set up a wave action in this fluid. The inner walls of the cochlea are lined with small hair-like structures, which are in turn affected by the wave movements in the fluid. These tiny hairs move according to the wave motions in the cochleal fluid. If a loud noise arrives, most of these hairs move, and in a more powerful manner. Every sound frequency in the outside world sets up different reactions in these hairs. Fine, but what does the movement of these hairs signify? What possible connection can these hairs in the cochlea in the inner ear have with our listening to a classical music concert, recognizing a friend's voice, hearing the sound of a car, and distinguishing millions of other sounds? The answer to that question once again shows the magnificent complexity of the ear. Each of these tiny hairs is actually a separate mechanism located on 20,000 or so individual cells surrounding the inner wall of the cochlea. This movement opens the ion channels in the cells lying beneath the hairs and permits the entry of ions into them. When the hairs lie back in the other direction, the cell doors close. This constant motion constantly changes the cell's chemical balances and allows them to produce electrical impulses. These electrical impulses are transmitted by nerves to the brain, where they are interpreted and converted into sound. Science has not yet unraveled all the technical details of this system. In producing these electrical signals, the cells in the inner ear manage to reflect the frequency, force, and rhythm of the waves from the outside world. This is such a complex process that science has not yet been able to determine whether the process of distinguishing frequencies takes place in the inner ear or in the brain. All the information we have considered so far shows that our hearing organ, the ear, possesses an extraordinary complexity. Close consideration shows that it has an irreducibly complex structure, because in order for hearing to take place, a great number of independent components need to exist together, fully and perfectly formed. If just one of these is removed from the ear, or else suffers a structural defect, then one will no longer be able to hear anything. In order for the ear to hear, such different elements as the external ear membrane, the anvil, hammer, and stirrup bones, the cochlea, and the tiny hairs inside it, all have to exist in perfectly functioning form. The system cannot develop in stages, because none of those stages on their own will serve any purpose. To suggest that an organ as complex as the ear was built in stages by a random process such as evolution is both unscientific and irrational. Organs possessed of irreducible complexity in living things, such as these, totally undermine the theory of evolution. They also reveal the fact that we are created by God. This same truth is revealed in one of the verses of the Quran. Say, it is He who brought you into being and gave you hearing, sight, and hearts. What little thanks you show. At the point we have arrived at today, science shows that life was created and reveals to us the omniscience of our Creator, Almighty God, the Lord of all the worlds.